What up, what up, what up, everybody? This is Dario Hunt from Blue Life Fearless. Welcome back to another episode of our Music Files podcast. Today's date is May 3rd, 2019. With me, as always, my co-host, Mr. Reese Walker. Say hello to everybody.
What's good, everybody? Welcome back. It's artist D. Walker here with Dario, chopping it up with another Music Files podcast. Thank you for joining us. And yeah, let's jump into some music.
Yeah, so we're going to hop right into it. Like always, we're going to take care of some housekeeping first. So if you are joining us once again or for the first time, and if you are liking these conversations that we are having, please smash that like and subscribe button wherever you guys enjoy us, whether that is on SoundCloud or YouTube or Apple Music or Google Play Music. We're kind of everywhere except for Spotify. So wherever you like to kind of listen to us or watch us and you enjoy it, please smash that like and subscribe button for us. And if you like any of the gear that I rock in these videos, like this hoodie here, this beanie I'm wearing, or that hat or shirt that Doris is wearing, if you're watching this podcast, you can also head over to the site and grab some for yourself from the shop. They are available right now. So let's get right into it. Got a bunch of music news that we kind of want to run through. All the ones coming up right now are pulled directly from our website over the past couple of weeks. So if you want to learn more about them, as always, you know, feel free to head over there and read the full articles. We're just going to kind of touch on them and just give our kind of opinions about it. So first and foremost, I feel like we've been talking about streaming for quite some time now. I feel like it's been a continuous topic of conversation, and it continues to be one. And I mean, it's not surprising considering that is kind of the new direction that music is going to continue to go. So in this new item, news item, Amazon is throwing their hat into the streaming services race yet again.
Yeah. Amazon. Of course.
So they've already kind of been into it. They did have like Prime Music that is available, obviously, with your Prime membership that most people have that they don't even know that they have. But there was that. That was already kind of included with that. And they also had a separate Amazon Music Unlimited for like $9.99 a month. But I guess reports are saying that they're releasing yet another one, an ad-supported free music service that would be voice-activated through Amazon's Echo speakers.
Interesting. Okay. So they're trying stuff, basically.
I feel like they're just throwing shit at the wall and hoping something sticks.
Yeah,
actual strategy about how they're actually going to compete with the likes of like Spotify and Apple Music and whatnot in Tidal.
Yeah. I don't know. Weird, but okay. I haven't seen anything. We'll see what happens. I think that they may be just testing the waters. This is probably an analytics game. They're probably rolling this out to gain information for a bigger project specifically related to music.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if this is tied to like Prime accounts, because like I said, they kind of already had their Prime Music and whatnot.
Yeah.
But they haven't really done a good job of advertising or giving people a real reason to use their Prime stuff outside of like free shipping and shit like that.
Yeah.
Because even with their Prime Video, they have actually some really good shows and even some acclaimed shows and movies, original stuff. But nobody really talks about it, or that I know of, really.
I haven't heard anything since Boardwalk Empire, to be honest.
Man in the High Castle is probably the one that I hear the most, maybe.
Yeah.
But at the amount of money that they're like spending on it, there's no way that they're actually making money off of it.
No. Definitely not. But Amazon's weird, because that's weird, because you can purchase albums already, like it's a store, an online store, yeah. like Apple Music, but is that going to merge with like a service where you have an Amazon catalog? Like, I don't know. It's weird. Because like,
Yeah,
if
it's
you
weird.
buy an album that's a product, how do can like do I have to re-upload the music I bought to the streaming thing? Or like, how do I get
Yeah.
that music like on?
I'm
I don't
not
know.
really sure how it's gonna work. They don't have all the full details. There are some more stuff that I haven't really talked about, but it's like they're like segmenting the whole streaming sector even more. And I
Yeah.
think a couple weeks ago we kind of talked about some streaming services popping up again
Right.
that are segmenting it even more. So there's no way that this is like sustainable. And I don't really see people leaving Spotify to go to Amazon, because what can he really offer that these other ones don't already have? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
And like, I know
I
they're
don't see
offering
a
like a free
plus
option,
to.
but Spotify does too.
Yeah, this kind of feels like Google Plus. Like it's a thing that's there that we kind of have, but
Everybody's into it, so like we gotta at least try.
yeah, but
Yeah.
like, is it gonna work?
Probably not. I would say no.
Yeah.
Definitely say no.
But hey, good. Yeah, I mean, they should throw their hat in the race though. I mean, fuck it.
They got enough
Streamers.
money to do it, so fuck it, I guess.
Yeah. We'll see what happens. Probably bring it back up. It'll probably be a topic in a few months again.
Yeah, that they're shutting down their streaming service.
All right. It's been overhauled.
But on April 15th, Aretha Franklin was awarded a posthumous Pulitzer Special Award and Citation. She is one of the recipients of the prestigious Journalism Art and Arts Prize for 2019, and the Pulitzer released a statement saying for her an indelible contribution to American music and culture for more than 5 decades. And Franklin is among a select group of musicians to re receive the special citations for arts. And among other musicians that have won this have been Rodgers and Hammerstein, George Gershwin, Duke Ellington, Thelonious Monk, John Coltrane, and Bob Dylan. And Hank Williams in 2010. So guess the big deal about this is that she is the first female recipient of the special citation for arts.
Yeah, that's a big deal. That's crazy. But I mean, it's also a big deal so she got it after, post Thomas. So I kind of wish she could have got something like that when she was still here, But yeah, being the first woman, that's crazy. Just that shows that like the legacy still opens the doors. But then it begs the question of like, what will this be a trend that they continue, or is this just like a one-time thing? Like where, 'cause there's Nina Simone, people like that you could think
Yeah,
of.
there's definitely a lot of deserving people
Etta
to
James,
get it. Yeah, and I mean, definitely Aretha Franklin is certainly towards the top of that list of deserving recipients, and I'm very
Absolutely.
glad that she got it. But I don't know,
Definitely.
because I mean, you saw the list, it's pretty short of musicians who have gotten it, and
Yeah.
it's pretty exclusive. So the fact that she's in there says a lot, and I'm not really sure
That's true.
how. I don't think it's gonna open it up anymore, but it's just that she's kind of like the first one to finally get in.
Yeah, definitely. It's a great nod. It's amazing. It's like obviously historic, so anyone that looks at that list or just is interested ever when those prizes come out will always see like her name
Oh yeah,
amongst
she
like
solidified,
so
more than solidified.
it's like that's amazing just to see the woman's name in the line of like however many men there are that won the award before her.
So yeah, shout out to Aretha Franklin, still killing it, no matter
For
if she's
real.
here with us or not.
Yeah, sorry, Nikki. Aretha's
So Bandcamp, as you guys all know, the online independent music giant, you know, the place where you go for a lot of like independent artists and independent labels to kind of speak directly to, you know, their fan base and their core base and offer a different kind of unique experience than you would get from let's say like Apple Music, which is very much just a digital storefront. They have decided to throw their hat officially into the vinyl game because as you know, on Bandcamp, a lot of their
That's
offers are
smart.
like for CDs plus something extra. And obviously the real exclusive thing, if you're a big fan, is you can buy the vinyl of a lot of those artists on Bandcamp. And
That's crazy.
vinyl is a real thing now. It's not really a fad. Like, it's a huge deal. It's a real part of music once again, and they have like a real market for it. And they have said that sales of vinyl records on Bandcamp have grown over 600% in the last 5 years. Meanwhile, CDs and music downloads are decreasing, obviously, thanks in large part to streaming. Vinyl continues to increase, and I'm sure the profit margin is much higher on vinyl sales than anything else they can do. So it's kind of a smart play. And they're entering it officially by starting their own kind of vinyl pressing service for independent musicians and labels where they can go through them directly.
Interesting. Interesting. So they're setting themselves up as like a distribution center, essentially, almost in the music game for records. Like, that's really dope. That's actually really dope. First
A
of
really
all,
smart move.
yeah, especially for Bandcamp. Like, because I actually forgot about that name. I was like, oh shit, Bandcamp. And then I was thinking about it and I was like, yeah, they were really good. Because I remember when Facebook pages had music pages and Bandcamp was just like what the Facebook page could have been for music pages, but never really
Or
was.
even like MySpace, kind of like when MySpace Music, I think, would be an
Yeah,
even better example.
exactly. And it kind of felt like a cleaner MySpace music page, basically. Like,
Right.
so that's what I really appreciated, was that it was like band specific. It's music website and the profiles are really strong. And now that they have a system where you can collect like physical, like collector's items, like the vinyl's not just to play the music, it's also to like collect it in a sense, you
Yeah, so
know.
say I'm a such of a fan that I actually have a physical kind of representation of my love for that like band and that album and that music.
Yeah, and
And
like
this
we just
taps
passed
directly into like that collector's like desire that a lot of people have, you know?
yeah, exactly. Because they can show it off, they can pull it out and play it, you know, like oh yeah, flip to the B side, like
It's
just
not just for hipsters anymore.
it's really not. And what's crazy is like we were talking about it a few podcasts ago, but just the national what was it? Album Day or music th what was that?
National Record Day.
National Record Day. Yeah. So like just the
Record
fact
Store Day. Record Store Day.
Record Store Day. So just the fact that that has continued to grow and this year was the largest across the nation in terms of re-releases and albums pressed for that day specifically. It's actually, I can see it just continuing to go upward from there. So like Bandcamp's, they're making a smart move right now.
Yeah, and some more details. What they're saying, there's no upfront investment from artist or label to actually create like a sort of campaign. So how it's going to work is they're going to create some sort of campaign, and once it hits a certain like funding goal from kind of like Kickstarter, where it hits a sort of funding goal from fans who are kind of pledging money that they want this to happen, Bandcamp will then press those records, print the packaging, and handle the shipping. So artists really don't have to do too much except set the price and design it. So it's kind of like a print on demand, but for vinyl instead of apparel, which you kind of see a lot. So I think that's dope. I think that's really smart, actually. It's like super smart, and
Yeah,
I think
that's
that could be
super
big.
smart. 'Cause there's no other, I don't think there's a service out there like that at all yet. Like particularly regarding
No,
vinyl.
especially not one that's like immediately tied to like a storefront that people already have. You know, they already have their band page and they already set up on Bandcamp.
Yeah. So I don't have to promote this other page thing. Like,
Right.
yeah, come to the thing you've been coming to, but like, yo, check it out. You can cop this vinyl here too now. Like, that's sick. Like, that's changing the game. Honestly, that's kind of dope.
Super smart move, super dope move, and we'll see how it works out for them, but I think it's gonna work out pretty well.
Yeah. At least for a while. I don't know what the swing will be, but it seems like vinyl's
Yeah,
here to
who knows
stay.
how long this vinyl kind of interest will last, but right now it doesn't seem to be slowing down anytime soon.
Yeah.
So, have you seen or do you remember the movie Almost Famous?
Almost Famous? That sounds so familiar.
It's by Cameron Crowe, and it is about kind of, I want to say his adventures or his life as a music journalist in the 70s. And he was like touring. He was basically almost like a roadie following bands across as they tour
Oh, kind of,
across the country.
yeah. Yeah, I remember. Definitely, yeah. Those are early 2000s movie. Okay, yeah. Yeah.
So Cameron Crowe himself is adapting that movie into its own musical, and it's going to debut in San Diego, which is where he is from.
Oh, wow. That's actually pretty crazy. But pretty cool. I wonder how it's gonna cross over into a musical, because from what I remember, the movie was pretty good, but I was like young at the time, so I couldn't like get everything. So I'd have to watch it again to know how like how really good it is. But I do remember it being a good movie and a
Yeah, and
long
the
movie.
movie, I guess the thing is, the movie had a lot of like songs from the 70s, and they're saying that this one's going to have mostly original
Yeah, it was like set then.
kind of songs. So I'm not really sure how that's going to translate because the music, I think, was just as important as like the actual movie that was going on
Right.
to really kind of connect you to that time. So I don't know how that would translate with original compositions and stuff. But yeah, if you're in San Diego, around September, so we're gonna run from September 13th to October 20th, and you are a fan of Almost Famous, go check that out.
Definitely.
So there's been a lot of Prince news kind of recently. We talked about him in our last Music Files podcast. That was more dealing with lawsuits, but now they are saying that Prince's unfinished memoir that he was working on before he died, it is finally set to see the light of day and has a release date for the end of October.
Ooh, that's gonna be a bestseller.
Who's getting the money? I don't know, because I'm pretty sure they still haven't figured out the whole Prince estate shit. So,
Yeah, that's
not
weird.
sure.
That's weird. Aren't they making a movie too? I heard there's a Prince movie in the
I'm
making.
sure there's one coming.
Yeah. But yeah, his official, like his memoirs. That's crazy though. That's crazy. I'm gonna read it. That's one book I will read if it comes out. But
Yeah, like I said, he never really got to finish it, but it's kind of a story about how he came to be Prince, and then I think it's going to include, let yeah, it's going to include some like handwritten lyric sheets and stuff like that as well to kind of fill it out in scrapbooks and photos and stuff like that. Previously unseen.
Right. Well, that's dope. Anything that's
Called The
previously
Beautiful
unseen.
Ones.
It's called what?
The Beautiful Ones.
The Beautiful Ones. Cool.
So, for all those Prince fanatics out there, you have one more thing to kind of, one last gift from him, basically, to kind of, latch onto. So.
Yeah.
I'll probably check it out. I've definitely become much more of a Prince fan as I've gotten older. I was all about Michael
Yeah.
Jackson in my younger days, but
Yeah.
I've definitely grown to appreciate difference in like just how fucking talented he was
Yeah, definitely.
as I've gotten older.
Yeah, for sure. Even when I was younger, I didn't get it, but then there was a moment when I watched Purple Rain, like the movie, that's when I kind of got it, 'cause I hadn't seen it before, until I was maybe like, I don't know, 12, 13, sometime, middle schoolish. So by the time I got to see Purple Rain, I already had like my idea of like who this Prince character was, and I already loved Michael Jackson. So like then I saw Purple Rain and was like, oh sh, Prince gets down, like like he's on a motorcycle, he's playing the guitar, jumping all over the stage, but he's like he looks crazy with his clothes. You're like, oh man, I would never wear that, but then you're like, why not? Like look at Prince killing it, like he had a beautiful woman as the antagonist, like just killing it. The whole thing was, I was like, damn, Purple Rain made me respect that fool forever. Like,
Yeah, I mean, like I said, I've definitely gained a whole new level of respect for him, especially his music, because I feel like Michael Jackson was just way more immediately accessible, especially
yeah,
as a younger kid. Immediately, you could latch onto it like that. Like,
right.
and Prince's stuff is far more intricate, and like, there's a lot more levels and layers to it that you kind of have to like understand more. And once you really understand everything he's doing, it's like, damn, this fool was like on another level for real.
Yeah, once you realize like, oh shit, he played all those instruments, you're like, oh shit, he's like, oh
He
damn,
wrote all this shit
he
too,
wrote
yeah.
everything. Oh, he wrote that for who? Oh, that's a Prince song? Like when you find out like what songs Prince wrote for other people, like, then you're like, wait, what? Like that, yeah,
Special.
it's crazy, yeah.
And it kind of sucks because it was like right when I was like really, really starting to get into him, he died. And I was like, damn.
Yeah, that's when I really was understanding him better. Like, really, that's when, around the time when I was finding out about these songs that he wrote for other people and stuff. And I was like, wow, I didn't know Prince was the brain behind that.
I really started to like kind of reconsider. It was always Jackson over Prince to me, but then it was like really starting
Yeah.
to reconsider that as I grew older and like really started to dig
That's
into his
how I
catalog.
started to feel, because then I was like, Prince didn't have Quincy Jones. Prince was the Quincy Jones of his shit.
Yeah.
Like in a way, like that's crazy to be Michael and Quincy in one.
Yeah.
That's,
Special.
yeah.
Special. So I'll
Prince is
definitely be checking
legendary.
out the memoir at some point.
Yeah.
And speaking of movies, I don't know, it's a little tangent, but you remember Michael Jackson, what movie that was? Pretty sure it was a movie. Michael Jackson like turned into a car.
Oh yeah, Michael had this short film kind of shit.
Was it a short film?
It was like, well, all his music videos were short films. I think it was like an extended video for the Criminal movie. Like there was the Criminal music video, but then he had this like extension where like the kids, 'cause remember when the kids run up to the window in the Criminal video and they
Yeah.
look in and he's in there? 'Cause those are the kids in this whole storyline, but they're like running through the city or some shit. Like they're trying to save something, but yeah, Michael turns into like a giant robot, like a like Optimus Prime or some shit at the end of it. Like I kind of remember it, but I don't remember what it's called or any. I don't remember exactly what it was, but it felt like an extension of the Criminal,
All
like
right, I found
Smooth
it.
Criminal.
It is Moonwalker.
Moonwalker. That's right, because then Sega made a video game after
Yeah.
that short called
So
Moonwalker.
the film was like concert footage, concept videos, and a career retrospective. I remember watching when I was younger and like watching him turn into a car. I was like, yo, what the fuck is going on? What, like, I've been
Fam, I was so
confused
confused.
about this for 30 years now. Like, I've been super confused, bro.
Yeah, I was confused, but I loved it. I like was like, hey, it's lit. No, he turned it into a car too. He was like a bulletproof Lambo or some shit.
That's what I'm
Like,
saying. I don't remember that shit. I just remember him turning to a car, and I was like, yo, what the fuck is going on?
yo, yeah. What did he turn into, a bulletproof like Lambo and then like a giant transformer? I yeah, he was on one right there. I was like, yo, Michael, I don't know what's happening. Like, who came up with this? Like, it's amazing, but it was crazy. It was crazy.
If y'all have, this is your first time hearing about this Michael Jackson turned into a car and robot and shit like that, I should highly suggest you go check out
Oh,
Moonwalker. I'm
you
sure it's
haven't seen that?
on
You
YouTube somewhere.
haven't seen that? You have to look at me. I'm looking at you. You have to find that. You have to watch that. That Michael Jackson shit is classic, legendary shit. You've never seen a video like that. Nobody, no artist has done
I've
anything
never
like
been more
that.
confused in my life at that age than watching that
Facts.
shit.
Facts. I just was waiting for them to dance again and
I was
shit.
like, is there nothing he can do?
For real. He almost dies, so he turns into a robot to save the world? Like, what? To save the orphans? Like, I
He's on another level. God
don't
damn.
know. Yeah. It was wild.
But yeah, it was just a little tangent. All right, so last news item pulled directly from the site, released this week, actually. Raymond Scott's mythical electronium instrument has finally been brought to life. If you aren't familiar with Raymond Scott, he is a revered jazz and electronic music composer and artist who was at one time the head of Motown's electronic music research. And if you have heard or watched the Looney Tunes or The Simpsons, then you have definitely encountered his music. So at some point in the 70s and 80s, he was working on this kind of secret instrument or device that was supposed to like let people play and compose music at the same time. So basically you could start with an idea of like a melody, then the device would transform it into a full composition.
Oh, that's right.
So it's almost like an algorithm, like one of the first like kind of algorithms that you put something in and then it'll spit out like a whole song or composition.
Right.
And he was doing this in the 70s and 80s when computers were, I don't even know what they were at that time.
Becoming a thing. Or becoming
Yeah.
computers.
Yeah.
That's when they were making them. That's when, yeah. That was the same time that Microsoft and Apple and weren't even Apple yet. They were the garage.
And this was supposed to be an analog device. So, but 50 years later, Yuri Suzuki is finishing it, and not as a completely analog device like he had envisioned it, but as a software powered by AI. But it does what kind of Scott wanted it to do. You can start with like a simple melody or even some notes, and then the AI composes like the rest for you. Then you can kind of add effects and stuff.
Weird. That's interesting.
I haven't seen any videos for it yet, but hopefully
I
I'll be able to see
gotta hear
this.
the music. Is the
Yeah, I want to
music
see
good?
this
You
in
know, I gotta
action.
hear what he's coming up with, you know? Like,
Yeah, I mean,
how's the
we
robot
did
mixing the sound? Like,
a couple weeks ago, we did talk about another AI project that
got
Warner
signed?
had bought that creates like basically entire albums and songs, based on mood.
Yeah.
So AI is getting thrown into more and more stuff, and AI music is going to be interesting.
Yeah.
You got a lot of mumble rappers out there rubbing their hands, they
Real.
ain't got to pay a producer no more.
Right? They're just gonna be like, all right, I want this sound and this sound. And they're gonna put their two favorite artist songs into an algorithm machine that's
Oh
gonna make
yeah.
a whole new beat for them and tell them what lyrics to rap. And then they're just gonna record the song that the algorithm gave them and then put
Lyrics.
it
Lyrics don't matter. You just need a melody. As if
on.
shit
Well,
wasn't
that's
easy
true.
enough.
Cause there's an artist, what's his name? Joji? That dude is mostly just melody in his songs, like, but
I'm
they're
just gonna say
dope.
this now. AI is going to take over that low bar segment of hip hop sooner than later.
Of everything.
So it's already super easy to make the sound, the songs and production that they're making.
Oh yeah, super, super.
So I don't think it'd be that much of a stretch to see AI be able to do that shit on their own. And producers are already getting fucked, so
I know, right? It's hard out here for producers. That's crazy.
trash producers is hard out here. When you're producing generic trash, it's hard out for there for you.
Well, they're trying to ride a wave. They're like, oh, that's the wave. I'm gonna make beats like that. Like, they're not innovating. You gotta innovate. You gotta create your own vibes and make relationships. You gotta know people. You gotta, reach out. Can't just be throwing shit out there.
Yeah, so that is it for news. Well, from news pulled directly from our site. Again, if you are interested in any of the kind of topics that we touched on and talked about, you should head over to the site and kind of get the full info and the full details of that in our news segment there. But gotta talk about this. Logic just dropped his third single from his forthcoming album, I believe called Confessions of a Dangerous Mind, and the song is called Homicide, and it features Eminem, and it's got some people talking.
Eminem's on it. Yeah, I first saw it and I was like, oh, Logic dropped another song. And I was like, wait, that's featuring Eminem? Oh, I gotta go straight to, like, I wasn't even hyped until I saw Eminem's name. Because to be honest, the first few singles didn't impress me that much. Like, I was kind of just like, I don't know if Logic's like getting too mainstream now or what, but I don't know. That song, that was the first time when I listened to it off rip. I was like, this is kind of what I was wanting to hear. Like, I haven't heard Logic sound like that in a while. It felt like.
Yeah, you never really know what shape a Eminem feature or song, specifically feature, is going to take these days. Because I feel like sometimes they try to be too left field with it and not just give you the rapping shit. But in reality, that's all you really fucking want to hear when you get an Eminem verse is the rapping shit. So I'm glad that that's exactly what they gave us.
Like exactly what we get. And what's so funny, the little skit at the end, like the
Yeah, during Chris D'Elia, his little impression of him that went viral, they put that in there as, a nice little funny touch to it.
That
Show that
shit
M
was
still
awesome.
definitely has a sense of humor, and I thought that obviously that shit was funny, so
Right.
glad to see that he noticed and put it on there.
Yeah. That was dope.
But overall, I'm very satisfied with what I got.
Oh yeah, that's the first time I felt good about Logic in a while, honestly. The other songs that he's put out have been decent, but nothing like to talk about. Really, I wasn't gonna be like, yo, you heard that Logic single? Like, nah. Until now I'm like, yo, you heard that
I
Logic single?
mean, the worst part about having somebody as big as like Eminem on your song is that people are saying, "Yo, you heard that new Eminem," instead of, "Yo, you heard that
Well,
Logic."
facts. Well, that's what it is, though. I mean, that's why he's
Yeah,
on there.
it comes with
That's
it.
why it's a big deal.
But
If it was just
Logic, I
Homicide
think, held
without
his
an
own
Eminem
for
verse,
sure.
yeah, if it was Homicide without an Eminem verse, it would have been fire, but just not, it wouldn't have made waves.
Nah, not like this.
Yeah, no.
And I gotta say, Logic definitely held his own.
Yeah, he did. And what's funnier is 'cause like, yeah, he did. I think I'm gonna have to go back to it again and listen to it hard and critically. 'Cause I know that Joyner and Logic have a beef, so I kinda wanna see if there's anything in there.
Yeah, that's interesting. Now you thought about it. I want to go listen to Joyner and him, then I want to listen to Logic and him.
Yeah. 'Cause I heard the story about Joyner and Logic on a Tech N9ne track and what happened with that. So now I was like, okay, I want to see, because Joyner was saying that Logic didn't come with the rappity rap. He was like joking around with it, and he's like, nah, that's what you're supposed to give us. Like you were saying, like that's what we coming for with that kind of collab. So like I was like, okay, Logic actually did it, because that's why I was so like unsure about going to the song. I was like, okay. What did they do with this? Was this like a joke? Like, were they like trying to play characters back and forth? Or like, what are they gonna give us? And then, boom, hit us with that rap shit.
Yeah, and apparently not everybody's been super happy with it. Like fucking Justin Bieber,
Stop.
like said some shit. I don't know if you saw that.
Stop it. Biebs came out of his mouth
Biebs.
to say something about Logic and Eminem.
Specifically, here's exactly what he said. Let me pull it up.
Yeah, I gotta know. 'Cause the
He said
Biebs.
that he likes Eminem's flow, but doesn't like the fact that Eminem is dissing other new rappers. He just doesn't understand it.
Oh, that's what the Biebs. Come on, Biebs.
Here's what I don't get. Here's the thing with M that people for years were saying, oh, we want the old angry M back. We want the old angry M. And then when he gives you the old angry M, you're like, oh, he just doesn't get it nowadays. He doesn't get new
Yeah,
rap.
I was like,
You know,
that's what he
like
was doing when he came out. Was talking
he was
about.
shitting on everybody when he came out. Like, I'm not understanding why people are so like
Yeah.
surprised and shocked by it when y'all been crying for the old M for so long
Fam,
that he comes out and gives you
if
that
he
shit.
replaced the names of like famous artists of today with the names that he was were in those old Eminem songs, that song would probably be banned. They probably couldn't put the song out like in today's sensitive ass times. Like the old Eminem shit, if you swap names into it,
And
like
I don't really know why he even said anything because, sure, they kind of talked about like new rap and new rap wave,
yeah.
but neither one of them even talk about anybody specifically. They don't
Yeah,
fucking
for
name drop
real.
anybody. And M barely even said anything. All he said was he doesn't want to listen to you spit your raps that someone else wrote, which I'm pretty sure is the sentiment of most lyricists in hip hop, that it's ghostwriting has always
Yeah.
been a big fucking deal.
True.
Even
I
though
think he
people
was
try to make it
piggybacking
not.
on it because Logic says something too, but he didn't mention
I mean,
Logic in
Logic
that.
wanted more than them, I think, about the whole new
Yeah,
wave of rap.
exactly. But I think that's why I think Biebs got triggered by Logic because Logic's verse is first
I'm
there
glad
with
as
that
Biebs even
part.
have a fucking opinion on this shit, but
Because Justin Bieber has a bunch of hip hop songs he can't put out and he's sad about it and he's trying to figure out what to do with his life. That's why there's no music out and there's a
nah,
bunch of just Justin Bieber leaks. I
he
have
has a
like
bunch
two
of those
albums of Justin
SoundCloud
Bieber
mumble
leaks.
rap friends.
Because Justin Bieber has mumble rap songs.
And mumble rap friends.
Yeah. I have a song from Justin Bieber that sounds exactly like Post Malone, but it's Justin Bieber.
What's the odds that we're gonna get a Justin Bieber line from him in his one of whatever next shit he does?
Oh my God, if Eminem does another track. He's definitely gonna say something about this. I'm putting 85%. I'm not gonna go a
85.
whole 100. I'm gonna go 85.
I'm
85%.
saying 90, 95.
Yeah. All right. For
And I'm
real.
here for it. I'm here for it all.
Yeah. Nah, that I mean he deserves it coming out of his mouth. Like the last thing I heard about Justin Bieber was saying that he needs to focus on his life and like whatever some fucking shit, like about being depressed or some shit. And then it comes out of his
He
mouth to
is
like
lost.
What are you doing,
He's
fam?
lost.
What are you doing? Like something about his marriage and shit. Like, I don't know. He was all caught up in some weird personal drama and then
He's a weird fucking guy, and he's only getting weirder by the day.
yeah.
I mean, I get it. You were famous, that uber famous at like 15. It's hard to kind of be come out of that
Oh, younger
normal,
than that, it was
but
like 13.
goddamn, he's weird. Yeah, to be that so fucking famous since then, like I get
Yeah.
it. It's impossible to come out normal from that shit, but he's definitely seen some shit for sure, and he's trying to kind of
I
figure
mean,
it out
others are doing
now.
well. I mean, Zac Efron, he did well. He did all right for himself. He toned it down.
Zac Efron was not on the same level as Justin Bieber, bro.
Well, yeah, that's true. I feel like
Bieber was oh, another
for
was
the
a
2 years
monstrous
that High
wave.
School Musical was a thing, they were on the same level.
Sure, no, they were not on the same level. It was big, but they were not on the same level.
It felt like it, the way everybody was talking about it.
Bieber was monstrous, massively
Yeah.
monstrous.
Yeah, that's true. Bieber's bigger than. Do you think who's bigger, him or Taylor Swift?
Fuck. At a time, for sure, Bieber.
Yeah.
Now, obviously Taylor Swift, but at a time, Bieber.
Word.
Speaking of which, hear about that shit that they're kind of like going, getting at Taylor Swift saying that she copied Beyonce shit. All right.
I didn't
I
look
mean,
into it though.
yeah, it was about the billboards. I didn't watch it because I'm not watching that shit. But apparently she did some performance at billboards, and she had a marching band with her for her new single.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, and it was like the whole Coachella shit, and then the Homecoming documentary. So it was like right after that.
Yeah, that's interesting. I would have to see.
I don't think, I
I'd
mean,
have
I'm
to see
not
the
that,
set design.
I wouldn't watch that and think, oh, she's culture vulturing.
I'd have to see the
You can't really have
choreography.
a claim to a marching band,
Yeah, no, like mad people have marching bands. Like
but mad people got mad
Beyonce
about
wasn't
it
the
that she
first
did it.
one to do it. Like, you know,
For sure not, but
Dave
mad people got
Chappelle had a
mad that she
marching
did it.
band in his block party, like before, you know,
Bro,
like.
marching bands are as old as fucking music itself in America, basically. Like,
Facts. Where do you
get the
think
fuck out
all
of here.
these drummers and fucking musicians come from? Like, they are all in marching band in high school, fam. Like, all these bands that we love were in marching band. Which is crazy to think about. Because I didn't even realize it at the time. But yeah, now I'm like, oh shit, all of them fools is in marching band. So I honestly can't say that she copied it. I have to see it first to like say what looks like what, you know? 'Cause the marching band itself can't just be like, oh yeah. But it seems like Taylor Swift's been on like a public just like downward trot, like people aren't fucking with her like they used to. So I don't know.
I mean, I didn't. I'm not gonna give a shit for that. People love giving a shit for everything she does, but I think that's kind of a reach. But yeah, she just can't win.
Yeah, just better watch it. If they're trying to cancel her for anything.
And speaking of the Billboard Awards, have you watched it? I'm
Didn't
sure you
watch it.
didn't.
I saw a headline that Drake and Cardi cleaned up.
Yeah, Drake had all-time record, broke all-time record. He took home 12 awards.
What did I tell you about the Billboard Awards, fam? The numbers don't
Billboard
lie.
Awards is trash and nobody watches it for a reason.
Exactly, because we all know what the numbers are. They just look at the Billboard fucking any time of the year. You can tell who's gonna win what. That's what I was trying to tell you about that.
You want top artist, top male artist, top song? Like, get the fuck out of here.
It's the streaming numbers. He broke all the records. You have to give it to him.
Garbage.
That's what I was saying. I was like, if I
That
broke the
garbage
record that year,
Scorpion album.
most streamed, fam.
Get the fuck out of here. Nobody
Yeah.
watches that shit.
Nobody watches it. I
He took
forgot it.
12.
I didn't know it happened until afterwards, until the headlines.
Yeah, he took 12 and Cardi took 10.
10. Swag.
So what is the Billboard's word? Is it literally just like streams and shit?
I'm tell
Because
No, it's not just dreams. It's sales.
the top R&B album is XXXTentacion 17. That's not an R&B album.
What do you mean?
That's an R&B album. 17, which I'm pretty sure came out how many years ago?
I would
Anyways.
put that in like urban contemporary. And well, I don't know why it's in a category. Oh, because it's charting. Because it's charting. Oh, I get it. So now that makes more sense. So I guess it's literally just the top charting things of the year. It's whatever charts the most of that
Is it
year.
really?
Yeah, it has to be. That's the only way that him being in that makes sense is
How's
because
it at R&B though?
I don't know about that category though. I just know that he does sing in it. And
Billboard
then
Awards are trash. There's a reason. Just looking at this reminded me why I don't watch that shit.
yeah. That's funny. That's funny that it's R&B. That's funny. I didn't know it was categorized like that.
Trash.
That's hilarious. Damn. Cardi got 10.
Imagine Dragons one. Okay. Top rock hours. Yeah, it's trash.
Streams. That one's strange. For
Yeah,
sure.
and that kind of brings me to the next point I want to talk about is they broke more records on Spotify. So they are the first kind of rock group, if you can even call them rock still, to have two songs that crossed 1 billion streams on Spotify.
Who?
Imagine Dragons.
Oh, Imagine Dragons. Oh, that's placement.
Thunder streamed 1 billion, and then recently Believer just streamed 1 billion, and Radioactive looks like it's probably going to break 1 billion as well.
Oh, Radioactive is, because Believer and Radioactive to me are like equally, they're like the same song to me,
They
honestly.
all sound, bro, all their singles all
Believer
sound
and
okay. All of
Radioactive.
their singles from the last three song albums all are the fucking same. Let's just be honest. They are all the same.
Yeah,
They changed the word and the one word that they keep repeating over in the chorus, but the
but it's
construction
fire.
of it is the same.
It's still fire.
I'm not gonna lie. You hear it? Of course it's they crafted something that is earworm, and they've been riding that shit to the fucking
Yeah.
ground. There's a reason that like rock pierced fans can't stand Imagine Dragons. It's because of this.
Yeah. Well, 'cause to be honest, when I first heard Imagine Dragons, I was disgusted.
Nah, I'm not gonna lie. When I first heard about Dragons, I thought these motherfuckers are fire. Their first album?
I
That shit was
thought,
fire. What?
yeah, their first album, but I didn't hear them their first album. I didn't know who they were
I
until
didn't know who
after
they
that.
were. Nobody really knew who they were. That first shit was fucking flames.
And I didn't even know that was them when it was on, honestly, to be honest. I had heard it and didn't know that
I don't
was
even
them.
remember the name of that album. I'm gonna look it up right now, but that shit was flames. I was like, yo, who is this?
It was just weird. I was trying, because honestly, I thought it was somebody. I thought it was like, it sounded like a mashup. It sounded like mashups, and like I wasn't sure if this was somebody else's like vocals into like some like new EDM or like what was happening, because like it, the hooks and everything sound pretty generic. So I was like, is this somebody I haven't heard that I
Actually, I don't
like?
even know if it's their first album or not, but Night Visions,
Night Visions.
Flames, Radioactive. That was a song, that was like the song that really put them over the top.
Yeah, I was like, that's the only one I remember. I
That shit was flames. I don't remember nobody. I was like, yo, these motherfuckers are gonna be massive. And sure enough, they're massive. But as each new album came out, this shit just kept getting worse and worse.
Well, I thought it would get better because of like when Kendrick did that whole joint with them at the album at
It's
the end.
gotten worse and
But
worse,
yeah.
and I
Oh
don't even
no, it's got
consider
way
them rock
worse. It's
anymore.
gotten way worse. I don't know. I
But
don't
they
listen to
always
them.
have like that one or two massive like anthems
Yeah.
that like just keeps them going.
Definitely. I don't know. I just look at them like Maroon 5 now. They're just over there.
Maroon 5's last album was actually fucking good. It was nothing but big singles, but it was actually good.
Yeah, but that's only, that's like if you're like
This
willing
one
to
doesn't even
listen to
have good
Adam though.
singles.
Yeah, but Adam Levine, like you gotta be in the right mood to listen to his voice all the time. Like his voice isn't that amazing. His tone.
Better than the Imagine Dragons voice or the lead singers.
Except for on those hooks, I'd rather on Radioactive,
That's
Adam
not even
Levine wouldn't
singing.
sound
That's just
better.
yelling. That's just
Exactly.
some shit that you would hear in a
That's what I'm
festival
checking
and go
for
crazy for.
when I wanna go to Imagine Dragons, I wanna hear some yell singing in a tight hook with some explosive sounds
With some big ass drums.
and a nice epic sound. That's what it is. It's energy music with
Oh,
some
it's straight energy. Don't get me wrong. It's
yeah.
definitely energy.
I don't want it to sing with energy. I want it to yell with energy. Like, give me some radioactive,
Oh,
radioactive.
yeah. And don't get me wrong. As much
Yeah.
as I'm shit on their singles,
Yeah.
they're fucking catchy. But Origins, garbage.
Yeah, I don't even. Yeah. That's okay.
But yeah, they just broke billion streams once again for the second time, making them the first rock group on Spotify to do so.
Hey man, they just dumbed down their lyrics to double their dollar. You
Their
criticize them
lyrics were
for
dumb to
it, yet
begin
they all
with.
yell holla.
No, they just doubled down on what they were already, well, fucking quadrupled down on what they were already doing.
Quadruple down. Yeah. is still working. It hasn't broken yet. So, watch. They're gonna be right there next to you.
So, gotta talk, Kanye. Are we
Oh.
just acting like he wasn't the douchebag he was last year and canceled like everybody was saying?
I'm not.
Because
I
it feels
haven't,
like people are welcoming him back already.
fam, I haven't gotten through one of the Sunday services all the way. As soon as I start to enjoy it, I turn it off because I get mad at him. Like, Kanye, man, fuck. I can't even watch it. No, like people, it's crazy. Like people are really falling for it because what Kanye has done, which is what he needed to do this entire time, was not talk. He's not talking to the media right now,
Yeah, he's just letting the music speak.
which is all he ever needed to do, and we would have never hated him ever, which is crazy to think about. Like if he never fucking talked and just let the music speak, he would still be one of he people would call him the greatest, probably. Now people don't even want to talk about him in music conversations because of what like drama it might bring to the conversation. It's a trigger word. Kanye is a trigger word now.
So explain to me exactly these Sunday services, because I've never really fully understood and I've never actually watched one. I've only seen like clips of them, some of the songs.
Well, obviously he's got a choir. So this
Yeah,
Sunday
the
service
whole
thing,
church aesthetic, he's really going for it. Yep.
right? Well, so you remember back the album Ye was announced to come out, or not Ye, but Yandhi, and then he canceled it, pushed it back. Then they were like, "Oh, he's going to Africa to record it." So Sunday service came from the Africa trip, and he started it there. And so his first Sunday service was in Africa when he was out there, and
So are these
apparently.
Yandy cuts?
Yeah, I think, well, I don't know if it's necessarily Yandhi cuts. I think it's Kanye's like new set. Like it's like he kind of went back to his old stuff and just jam sessions with a fucking gospel choir. Sorry, excuse me. He jam sessions with a gospel choir and like completely changes old songs and rearranges it so it sounds new, but then there's some new stuff here and there, but it's really just like a live instrumentation with chorus with a choir of just like his more spiritual songs. It's not even like it's not really mostly new content. It's mostly old content. It's not even new cuts, 'cause you would have heard you there'd be snippets of new cuts out and there's not any snippets. So it's really him like doing the he's putting the ultra light beams on every song that he likes that he made, basically treatment. You know, like the Jesus walks, he's trying to paint the picture that he's like reverting back to the Jesus walks days, but he's not, obviously. And the only reason I say obviously is because the thing that following this is controversy about his merch for the
Yep,
Sunday service.
which I was going to get into. But before I get into that, I just wanted to say, like, I mean, it's kind of smart because it's hard to remain angry at somebody who is yelling or pushing, God and religion and stuff like that in their music and everything they're doing. So it's kind of smart. This was the plan to kind of get back in good graces. It's hard to be like, fuck him, fuck what he's doing, when he's pushing
But see, word on
religion
the
and God
street
and
with
stuff, man.
that is like because you want to feel that way, then you think about it more in all the stuff when he was like, the Trump stuff and the slavery of choice and everything. Like, all of the conservatives are God-fearing Christians, like this also, like caters to them. It doesn't exclude them. So it just because it's getting back into the good graces of his old fans doesn't mean he's not still catering to the people
I mean, look, I've never really given a fuck about any of that. It's always been about the music, and I'm not gonna lie, I don't really check for hip like that. But the clips I did hear, I was kind of
No,
like,
some of it sounds amazing.
okay, yeah, you might be able to get me really back into this shit. You keep putting out some heat
Oh
like
yeah,
this, them
definitely.
vibes like that, that shit that really hits you. But at the same time, like you said about the controversy surrounding it with the merchandise, is kind of like, I don't really like this shit though. Like, you selling socks for like $70, $50, whatever the fuck it
Yeah,
was.
church
Like,
socks for
yo,
like
like
$60
you
or something like
selling these sweatshirts for like
to say church
nearly
socks.
$400 that say like one thing on them, like screen printed on it. Like, yo, what the fuck is going on? Because I'm pretty sure this is the same Ye 2, 3 years ago talking about he wanted to produce affordable shit because people like him from his communities can't afford the shit
That
that
was
put
the
out.
whole
And now
point of
this is
the
not,
Yeezys,
yes, and this is not
in
no
his
Adidas
words.
collaboration.
Yeah,
This is strictly Ye shit, and he's out here pushing sweats for fucking $400. Like,
Yeah,
that shit
dog.
to me is some cornball, like some sleazeball type shit, bro. Like,
Oh,
and you're
yeah.
talking about Sunday service, church stuff, and you're literally printing just a sweatshirt with the screen print that says stuff like trust God or something like that. And you're selling it for $400. Like, all right, I get it. Like, I see why people are upset about that. Like, that's some sleazeball shit right there.
Because not only is it just it's just gross. It's just like Kanye's attaching himself to
Fucking
something he
gross.
shouldn't be attaching himself to. Like, it was one thing to be like Yeezus and then like in songs say like I am God and then like I don't know, it's just weird like putting out merch that way. Even
It's
without the
gross. It's
music.
disgusting.
I
I'm not
just
even
feel
that
like the
religious.
music's the only reason we're not in an uproar, like mad. Like if he just put that out first, like, oh, yo, this is my a new line for what I'm about, the music I'm about to release. Like we'd be like, what? It would sell out,
I'm sorry. It's fucking
but
gross because this is the same guy
he's making
that
religion
was
hype
talking
now.
about I'm
That's kind of
producing. I want to
disgusting. He's making
produce
religion
affordable
hype now.
shit.
Yeah,
I want to
how do you
produce
make
affordable shit.
Trust
That's what he
God
said.
hype beast? That's fucked up.
I want to produce affordable shit for people in my community because kids can't afford the shit that these other brands are pushing out, and I want to do that. Okay. Balls in your fucking court. This is not no Adidas collaboration. This is you pushing out $400 fucking sweatsuits that say trust God and are all churchy and shit like that. And now you're just making it into like a trendy thing. Like, you're just selling your shit. Like, it just feels fucking gross. Like,
Yeah, so as much as the Sunday services sound great, I still not really fucking with Kanye right now.
yeah, that shit's disgusting to me. I was like, when I seen that shit, I was like, what? I'm off this, dude. Like, fuck that. I'm not, I mean, you not, bro. I'm not buying a single shit that Kanye produces in terms of apparel. I'm not.
Yeah, no, I don't own anything, Kanye. I never have, aside from music.
Like, okay, it's one thing to sell shit, expensive clothing. Obviously, a lot of people do that. Especially if it's through Adidas, who controls most of the pricing. But then it's another when you do it on your own, then you try to attach it to like God and religion and church, and it's like, bro, like
And it's
what the
overpriced.
fuck?
Like, if it was just regular price, I don't know.
And it's all for profit, and you're like making it to like this trendy, like it's just,
Yeah, like,
ugh.
it was all for profit. It wasn't like actually going to a church or like, you know, like, it was just like your
It's like,
merch.
it's just sick. Sick
Yeah.
fucking guy. I'm sorry. That's just gross. I don't care what nobody says. You can say, oh, other people do it, yeah, sure, but this is the same person that was yelling 3 years ago about how you wanted to create affordable clothing and all this shit, and then talking all this bullshit. And when he finally has a chance to do it, what does he do? He does this.
Kanye just
So
lies.
fuck him.
Yeah,
Fuck him.
see, like people, here's the thing. I love Kanye's music from all the way up until Ye, basically. But the thing about Ye is that like the more he talks, the more you realize he lies to us as like public. Like, when he
Full of
says
shit.
things, he lies. And that was a lie. Like, that was a lie. This is a lie. Like, I saw him say he wanted to make things, more affordable, more accessible, and then that never happened. Like, he literally said that before making, like, I think his first Yeezy, he was complaining. And he's made at least like three or four more shoes now, like the fourth shoe. So like, he never like, you're negotiating the deals. Like, how do you not ever? Why? Like, what? What are you doing?
Fuck him. Fuck him. Fuck
He's
him. Fuck you.
lying.
If you still like support that shit and believe the shit he's saying, fuck him, bro. Like, fuck him.
Kanye's a liar.
I don't watch that Sunday service shit. I'm not ever going to watch the Sunday service shit. And he's out here talking about he wants to open a church. I'll never fucking step foot in none of that shit.
Yeah,
Like,
about that. I'm cool.
this dude out here is on some other
I'm
shit right now.
cool. Yeah.
And it does not feel right.
And
Sorry.
why is it? And it's so weird, 'cause like now Kim K is like in everybody's good graces. His wife,
I don't fuck with her
meanwhile,
either.
his wife is said she's gonna go to school to be a lawyer.
Good luck with that.
Yeah. You
I would
know.
never fucking hire you. Good luck with that.
Yeah, but hey, who knows?
People are stupid.
People are very easily manipulated.
But all
Not
right,
Kanye
so
does.
those topics definitely went on longer.
That's true.
We did want to talk about some type of album before, so I think we're gonna kind of nail this down to only a
Schoolboy.
few at the most.
Yeah.
I think the one that we both wanted to definitely talk about is Schoolboy Q and Crash Talk, much
Crash talk.
anticipated.
Yeah. Very much anticipated, because Schoolboy only drops every 2 or 3 years.
2.5 years has been.
Yeah, 2.5. So, basically, we've been waiting. And he's been apparently holding it off because of unfortunate deaths that we all know about. Mac Miller was a good friend, and I think he was gonna drop early fall and pushed it back, and then was coming up and started his rollout, and then Nipsey passed, so then he pushed it back again. So I don't know, it's been a tough rollout for Schoolboy, but
But I don't think rollout has ever really mattered so much for him because his fans are his fans and people are gonna tune in no matter what he drops at this point.
yeah, true. It doesn't his the rollout doesn't matter for his fan base, but in terms of gaining new fans, the rollout matters. But 'cause I don't know if so basically let's just jump into the project,
I mean, all right, so you said gaining new fans, and right off the back, I feel like he was kind of trying to do that here, specifically with some of his features and some of his production choices.
Right. With the single specifically, lead single specifically.
I mean, it feels like there's a bunch of possible singles here that he's going for.
Yeah, but he threw Chopsticks out with Travis Scott. So, 'cause that
Don't like
one,
it.
I hated it. I still, honestly, I let it rock, and if I'm not paying attention to the song and it's like playing in the background, I don't hate the song, but if I'm actually listening to it, I don't like it. I just don't like the song. I don't like
And
the
I'm
hook.
kind of getting tired of people just throwing Travis Scott and everything, like it's gonna magically turn into a hit song.
Yeah, that's not the wave. But hey. But that was the lead single, which I was kind of concerned about. That kind of like made me feel weird. But then he put Num Num Juice out, so that was the follow-up single.
That was definitely more of his lane.
More, yeah, that was his song. Like, I feel like Chopsticks was a label decision or something. I don't know what that was, but it felt forced. But Chopstick.
Well, in recent interviews, he has expressed disappointment in Blank Face in that he was disappointed in how kind of dark it was.
Oh, that was the best part.
Yeah, 1,000%.
That
stuff. It was like, it was so what good, do you mean, was because school it was like so.
It was dark as fuck.
Dense and dark and like sophisticated, and
yeah.
It just really showed him as an artist. Like, he really, really went into shit and like really took the time to really craft these intricate songs where shit beat breaks down and certain voices come in, certain verses come in, and like one shit drops out, one kind of concept drops out, another one drops in. Like, it was just really dense. And yeah, it was a little dark. But I feel like his music has always been a little dark, so I'm not really sure why he was like so upset about it. Because
I was like, your album cover's got a paper bag slouching down, like they're sad and depressed, like over the dude's head. Like, what are you talking about?
Yeah,
that's a dark album cover.
I think, I don't know how other people feel, but Blankface was my favorite LP he's put out so far, and I think that was like him really kind of really finding his lane and his stride, and like. I was really looking.
I don't know. I like. I fuck with Habits and Contradictions heavy. Does that count?
It's more of a mixtape, but
yeah. Well, that all right. Well, that and Blankface. Yeah, those are my top two projects out there. I mean, he only has what, like five, four or five.
Oxymoron.
Oxymoron, yeah.
And he had one before Habits and Contradictions. I just can't remember the name right now. But that was like early days.
Yeah.
I just think, like, that, like you said, that was the best fucking part of the album. Like, was that darker shit, more menacing type of music. Like, I fucking loved that shit.
Yeah, it was like, it was like boogeyman shit. Like, it was like, it was like some dark, like, it was like, yeah. It was like a different homie. Like, instead of Kendrick taking us through, like, L.A., it was like, you know, an innocent kid, like a good kid. It was like a bad kid. You know, that's what, like, yeah. Blankface felt like the bad kid in the city instead of, like, the good kid's take.
Like, to me, I still fucking love that Eddie Kane song with Jadakiss. Like, goddamn, that shit was fucking special.
Yeah.
And I'm disappointed to see him kind of run away from that and kind of go in the more mainstream route and radio route here.
Yeah.
The push with the certain production choices he did, I was a bit confused, like.
Yeah, there's a lot of new sound that I wouldn't associate with him at all on this album. And I don't know. I'm still trying to, like, I don't know. There's a few songs that I still go to for sure.
Crash.
Like, there's songs that are amazing that are weird in the context of everything. Like, Tales is a great song.
Tales is phenomenal.
Like, that song, dope. Black Folk, dope. Like, these are really, like, dense songs, but then, like, in the mix of all this other stuff sometimes, it felt weird to switch from, like, I'm thinking about the lyrics to now I don't have to think that much about the lyrics.
Right. And those songs, while some were kind of catchy, they don't really make any serious, significant, like, impression.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, I don't think they're going to tear up the charts and, like, gain new fans like that. I just think they're just going to kind of be stuff that you could slap in the whip real quick, but then something you're not really going to want to return to over and over again like you did on Blankface.
Yeah. Yeah, nah, there's nothing that like, feels like a major hit, which is kind of disappointing. I mean, I think Water with Lil Baby is a better single than Chopsticks.
I mean, it seems to be definitely, in a viral sense, especially meme sense, it's definitely the one that's been catching on the most.
Yeah. Well, that one's definitely, I feel like that song has the most replay value on the album in terms of like outward with like group setting replay value.
I was just confused overall. I was confused, like, what he was really trying to go for.
Yeah, because the Ty Dolla $ign song was weird. It was good, but weird.
Yeah. And, like, some of these songs would have been fine if it was just, like, one or two or even three of these on the album.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact that he's got, like, over half of it are, like, these type of songs, it felt like, yo, like, what's going on here? And the fact that they're only, like, 2 minutes, 2.5 minutes, and where he had songs on the last one that were like almost five and a half minutes long, like really dense songs that you could go through. And this is just, I just think this was like him like overthinking shit, like.
Oh yeah, I feel like he totally overthought it, 'cause this doesn't even feel nearly as cohesive as his other work, like all of his other projects. Like
There is no cohesion to this.
everything he put out before this felt like smooth, like I don't know. It's weird. But what do you think about Kendrick doing like Schoolboy Q's ad-libs and stuff and like never being featured or anything?
I've been fine with it. I'm like,
'Cause he's on a few songs here too that I like noticed. I was like, oh shit, that's Kendrick doing that.
I don't need every TDR artist to have like Kendrick on there.
Yeah. Well, Kendrick like kind of EP, he like he goes through like Schoolboy lets Kendrick look at his shit and like change stuff.
I
So
mean, yeah, I mean, I'm fine with it. It's just, and I really actually do like the Dangerous songs
the
with
Cudi
Kid Cudi.
song, yeah, that's actually a
Super
good
like trippy
song.
and wavy.
I like that one.
But overall, like I said, it's just very confusing. I felt like a confusing album, and one that I
Yeah.
don't hate, because I don't really think he puts out outright bad music for the most part. It's just felt like a major misstep and like overthinking shit and
Yeah.
not really understanding what people wanted from him. I don't go to queue for like
I never
radio
want a
songs.
chopsticks from Schoolboy Q. I never
No, I
want
don't
that
need that
song
shit
from
from him.
Schoolboy.
I don't want a
Yeah.
radio song from Q. Like, who
Yeah.
cares? It's streaming now. Nobody really gives a shit about that.
Yeah, fuck all that.
And it just felt like he was reaching a lot of times here.
Yeah. So for me, it was a lukewarm project.
Yeah, so before, I mean, we go, like, I was just dropping now that I started a new series called Let's Talk Music, and my first week, I just dropped today, and I talk about the Q album, and I kind of categorize things as fuego, meaning must listens, worth the listen, and hard passes, and this one was definitely in just the worth a listen category, meaning it's not like great or the best outs, but it's still worth listen to kind of create your own kind of opinion from it.
Yeah.
So I want you to give me one album that you really want to talk about, and then go from there.
One album. Well, fuck it. I'll just mention Queen Herbie. And it's Queen Herbie put out a EP. She's I remember her from going viral, basically, like back before viral was a word, like a big thing. But like Chris Brown and Busta Rhymes had that song You See Me Now or something like that, and Busta had that really fast verse, and basically she like spit the verse on YouTube and like everybody went crazy for it. So then she like ended up on like talk shows and like did that and stuff, and but whatever, she was a musician, actual artist, and like has been putting out EPs, and it's Queen Herbie with a V, so it's QVEEN and then HERBY, and her EPs are just titled by numbers, so this is EP 6, and yeah, it's only 5 tracks, so it's a quick listen. But right off jump, the intro was really strong. It's called New Bitch. And honestly, in terms of like that kind of rap, I think it's definitely in the higher, like better than not category. It's worth a listen. Just like, we're kind of talking about with the Schoolboy thing. It's a project definitely worth a listen. It's definitely not trash. She's a great singer. The production's pretty fire. And the best song I would say is Mozart. It's got two features, both female artists, and yeah. There's just bars in there because it's dope. Because she's a singer and a female rapper, so she's out here.
What's the name?
Queen Herbie.
Queen Herbie.
Yep.
Okay. Now I'm super unfamiliar with
And yeah, if you guys haven't seen any of her, like, videos, just YouTube Queen Herbie and you'll find some shit. You might even want to check out, when I typed her name into my YouTube to see the search, like the third thing said like Busta Rhymes. It's like Queen Herbie, Busta Rhymes, because like I said, that's the thing she got like viral for like 8 years ago. So yeah, but new shit she put out, EP6, Queen Herbie, pretty fire.
All right, check that out. I'm gonna give one album that I think people should check out, and that is J Electronica and New Job A's called New Electronica. And no,
Wait,
this is
what?
not new J Electronica music.
Oh, okay.
This is sort of a remix compilation project put together by, I think, this label called Art. Altered Crate. I think that's what it is. Don't hold me to that. But it's called New Electronica, and New Job A's is a Japanese hip hop producer who passed away in 2010. And obviously, J Electronica is the guy who talks about music more than he actually releases music.
Right.
So this is them kind of putting together production from him, from New Job A's, that's like rarer, lesser known, and combining it with like unreleased a cappella verses from J Electronica. And New Job
Unreleased.
A's,
So it is new?
yeah. I mean,
New
unreleased or,
bars?
yeah, bars. Unreleased or probably very few have heard or, not
Well,
well
I'm gonna check for
circulated.
it then. I didn't know about this
And
project.
New Job A's is somebody that I actually had to, again, I don't know if I'm saying his name right, but it's spelled NUJABES. Is, like I said, deceased, and he's somebody I kind of had to do research into because I didn't know who he was. But he produced for like animes, some stuff like soundtrack animes for like Samurai Champloo, back in the day, which was created by the same people who created Cowboy Bebop. So his production is hip hop, but then it's like mixed with jazz, and
That's lit.
it's fucking phenomenal production, like super fire production,
Hell
and it's
yeah.
like the perfect soundscape for J Electronica and
Yeah,
his
no, I'm
verses.
like, that's where he lives. It's like, ooh.
It's like
I'm like kind of hyped now.
that perfect lane, and Jay really, again, no matter how you may feel about Jay, there's no denying that he's fucking talented, and there's a reason why people have been so hyped for him. It's that the bars and like his delivery and everything is fire, and there's no less fire here. If anything, it's more fire because the production here is so fucking good. So you should 1,000% check this out if you love hip hop.
Yeah.
So yeah, we didn't get into a lot of or all the albums that we kind of wanted to talk about because we had some longer news topics, but I think we had a good discussion. Didn't want to cut those short.
Yeah.
So we will get to those, in the next show or one of the upcoming shows. But before
Definitely.
we get out of here, I want to talk about some new albums that you should be on the lookout for dropping either this week or next week. Starting with May 3rd, today. So Bad Religion is dropping an album called Age of Unreason. Frank Carter and the Rattlesnakes is dropping End of Suffering, which I've actually heard, and it's pretty fucking good. Vampire Weekend, which I'm really looking forward to, is dropping today, called Father of the Bride, and I'm hearing really good things about them in
So.
this project. Unknown Mortal Orchestra is dropping an EP called SB-06. The Nationals, is this dropping? No, it's a single. Diplo dropped an EP called Higher Ground. Big Thief dropped a project called UFOF. Ashley Tisdale's dropping LP called Symptoms.
Wait, she's a singer?
Pile. Yeah, I guess.
Word.
Pile is dropping a project called Green and Gray. Once again, I've heard this one thanks to some PR people, and it's pretty fucking good too. I have to talk about
Dope.
that later. PnB Rock dropped, I think what you told me was his kind of major debut.
Yeah, so PnB Rock, his official album debut from the record label. He's basically he got signed like 4 years ago, and every project he put out, the label didn't classify as an album. So this is his first album, debut album, Trap Star Turned Pop Star, PnB Rock. Dropped today. So he has a verse from
Alaska, Alaska.
XXXTentacion.
Okay.
Sorry. But yeah, continue.
Check that out if you want. Alaska, Alaska, The Dots. Club Kuru, Meet Your Maker. Another one that I've heard through PR people. It's quite good as well. A lot of these I'm going to talk about. The Dream Syndicate, These Times. See. There was like a ton of major projects dropping today, but there's like a lot of lesser known projects and people dropping.
Styles P.
So it's Styles P
SP the GOAT, ghost of all
dropping
time.
SP the Goat. Not got a chance to hear that one yet. Yeah, and I think I'm gonna stop it there for May 3rd. And we'll leave May 10th for later because we will probably get another one of these up next week. So yeah.
Word.
That is it for this week's Music Files podcast. As always, if you are liking these shows that we're doing, whether you're listening to them through whatever audio format or audio platform that you listen to podcast through, or you're watching us through YouTube, we would highly suggest and highly and would be very grateful if you smash that like and subscribe button for us. Like I said, I dropped a new series this week called Let's Talk Music, where I kind of give a rundown of some of the albums that I've been listening to that I think you should listen to or that you should pass on. So you should also definitely check that out. If you have any questions, comments, or topic suggestions about this show, past show, or any future shows, you should also let us know in the comments down below wherever this goes up and wherever you enjoy, listening or watching us. Or you can email us directly at podcast@livinglifefearless.co and we will either get back to you or you may come up in a future show. And if you like any of the gear that we rock in these videos, if you do watch these podcasts, like this hoodie, this beanie, that hat, or that shirt that Reese is wearing, you can grab these for yourself directly from the store. But again, thank you guys for joining us once again and listening to us, and love to have you hop in the conversation. So don't be afraid to comment. We'll be back shortly with another one of these. Hopefully next week we will see. But until then, keep doing what, DeReese?
Keep living life fearless, y'all.
Yep.
Music
We'll catch you
files.
guys soon.
Like, comment,
Peace.
subscribe.